I appreciate it, and thank you all for coming out. Heard a little bit about them, but I was the chief scientist for the Aquarius Reef Base in Key Largo, Florida, and here you see that's the undersea lab, and I've actually twice now had the opportunity to live underwater for 2 weeks to study coral reefs. I taught at Sea Education Association, and I would spend 6 weeks on shore teaching oceanography to undergraduates, and then I'd go out to sea on a tall sailing ship for 6 weeks. How's that sound? Pretty good? Unless you get seasick. Then maybe not. A good friend of mine, this is a great friend, has he builds submersibles. So several times I've gotten to be the test, you know, observer to go down on his submersibles, which has been fun. I have probably one of the best jobs in the world. I am the science advisor to Celebrity Cruise small cruise ship in the Galapagos Islands. And that's a picture from the Gulf. And so in that job, I have to go to the Galapagos 2 to 3 times a year. Oh, it's horrible. It's horrible. I was just there actually recently. And I spent a lot of time in the Caribbean and as a student and in doing graduate work. And then here's one of my latest adventures from last year. What animal is that? You guys must recognize that.
Manatee.
How many of you have been to Crystal River to swim with the manatees? Quite a few. Well, last March, I went up there to swim with the manatees. Now, you all probably know this, that the law is you can't touch the manatee. But there's nothing that says if the manatee wanted to touch you. So this manatee came up to me, snout right there. Next thing I know, it grabbed me with its flippers. And see that picture? That's actually me being hugged by a manatee. It hugged me so tight, I was laughing so hard that I spit my snorkel out, and that's why you can't see my head. So I always recommend, I think, going to Crystal River and having the experience to swim with the manatees is one of our best ways to gain support to protect them and to protect their habitat. But I can't guarantee one will hug you, though it was the best. the title. One of the things, after... In the midst of all those jobs, I discovered a real love for writing, something I never expected. And I've tried to take on topics that, you know, sometimes they're written about in kind of a boring way. And so how do you get people engaged to learn? And so I went to a conference on marine biodiversity, and I came away thinking, oh my gosh, if we talk about marine biodiversity the way these scientists are, nobody's going to care about it. So I started thinking about ways to make it more engaging. And I came up with a title called Weird and Wacky Under the Sea and Why These Creatures Matter. And my scholarly publisher thought, oh, that sounds pretty good. Well, as you see, that's not the title. They accepted the book with that title. And then as I was doing my research, some very intriguing themes evolved. Turns out that more organisms than I ever knew in the ocean use mucus in some way. Whether it's to defend against predators, to capture food, to travel over, it's really slimy under there. So slime. Turns out, also, that there are a lot of very interesting reproductive strategies to bring forth the next generation. Okay, there's a lot of kinky sex going on in the ocean. And finally, while I knew many of my colleagues were working in a field that we call oceans and human health, I didn't realize the breadth and diversity of marine animals that are being used either as biomedical research models or in the new search for pharmaceuticals. So voila, the new title, Sex, Drugs, and Sea Slime, the Ocean's Oddest Creatures and Why They Matter, evolved. Took a little arm twisting to get University of Chicago Press to go with that title. I think they're pretty happy now. So before I bring forth to you some of my favorite stories from this book, I have to give you a little warning. Viewer discretion is involved. Content includes undersea animal nudity and explicit reproductive language, so don't be shocked. The first chapter in the book is called The Invisible Crowd, and it's really about the microscopic organisms in the ocean. And this is an image of, through a microscope, looking at a drop of seawater. in some places, turns out you could have a million organisms in just a teaspoon of seawater. Many of them are floating plants, what we call the phytoplankton. Some of them are floating animals called zooplankton. Here's sort of in this image a mix of the two. And you can see there are some really beautiful designs. I will tell you there are some monsters, albeit in miniature. And even in the microscopic realm, they are slime. Here's one of my favorite images that I got for the book. It's a very unusual image. Anybody here ever heard about foraminifera? A couple people. Well, usually when you hear about foraminifera, you just hear about their shells being found to use in studies of things like climate change, whatever. But this is a picture of a live foraminifera. They are amoeba-like animals that live inside these tiny test-like shells. They're made of calcium carbonate. Usually they're either like one little miniature golf ball or a couple stuck together like a cluster of grapes. So you have an amoeba living inside. And what they do is they float around in the ocean, and when bacteria or particles float by, they use their arms of mucus, aka slime, to reach outside from their shell, and that's what they feed on, and they grab them. But there's something very unusual about this picture. Notice it has spines, that helps keep it afloat in the ocean. And see these dots? What do you think the dots are? Any guesses? Eggs, that's a really good guess. What was that?
Lure,
that's a good guess. No, they are algae cells. So in the morning, with its arms of slime, the foraminifera takes cells of algae from inside its shell, puts them out on the spines during the day to photosynthesize and grow, and then right before dusk, it pulls them back into its shell. And that way, if there's not a lot of food floating by, they've got their own farm inside. Pretty cool. And this is a really great image. I got this from David Karen at the USC. He gave from his lab who studies them. Very hard to get this. So many of the animals that are planktonic or live in the microscopic world are larvae that, as they get older, you and I would recognize them, what their adults are. But when they're young, they're pretty darn hard to tell what they are. So I like to play a game we call Mystery Young. I'm going to show you the larvae, and I want you to guess what it is. Now, any biologists in the room, you can't play because that would be cheating. So you non-biologists, let's just hear your best guess. So anybody, what do you think this is? It's not a Pac-Man. It's not a video game creature. It is? Any guesses?
Fly.
A fly? Okay, I'll give you a hint. It all lives in the ocean. It does look like a fly. What do you think? An octopus, very good. Oh, I actually heard somebody say it. It's a crab. So it goes through a lot of stages as it grows. Okay, how about this one? I hear shrimp, lobster. What's the consensus? Seahorse. It is a spiny lobster. Okay, how about this next one? Ooh, this is a tricky one. It looks like a tadpole, doesn't it? I'll tell you, no, that's not it. Horseshoe crab, good guess. It is a sea squirt. They actually swim to the bottom, and they lose that tail, and they just turn into this simple tube-like creature. Okay, this one gets everybody every time. What do you think?
That's a shrimp.
A shrimp. Other guesses?
Squid.
Squid, that's what everybody thinks. So squid. You ready? It's a sea star. Yeah, I would have said octopus. Okay, this one's a little easier. What do you think? It's a fish, yes. It is a fish. What kind of fish? Flounder, you're right. But notice something very strange about the larvae. It has eyes on both sides of its head. As it grows, one eye actually migrates over the top of its head, and one side becomes blind, and they lie down on that side. And all flatfish do this. Some eyes migrate to the left, and some eyes migrate to the right in different species. Yeah, they also lose that funky headdress, that dorsal spine. Another animal that we consider plankton in the sort of microscopic world is the euphausid, also known as krill. And I wanted to put it in here, not because there's something mysterious about it, but because it's so important in the ocean ecosystem. This is like the energy drink of the sea. They are packed with protein, They feed seabirds, fish, whales, incredibly important. And so why should you care about? One of the things I did in this book is at the end of every chapter, every chapter has sort of wacky creature stories, and at the end, I wanted to tell people why you should care about them. So why should you care about plankton? You know, it seems kind of far-fetched. Well, it turns out almost all fish at some point in their life feed on plankton. So how many of you like to eat fish? A lot, I bet, here, right? So you like to eat plankton. Something like 520 million jobs across the world depend on fishing, fisheries, or aquaculture. And since those fish are eating plankton at some point in their life, 520 million jobs worldwide depend on plankton. People are starting to use them in health products like face creams and krill for krill oil. And also, that's really interesting, they discovered that in the sort of exoskeleton of a shrimp or crab, there's a compound that promotes blood clotting. And they're using them now in bandages, in specifically in military operations or trauma situations. So there's also biotechnology being used from plankton. And of course, you know, the face cream, and people are going to say that we're going to start eating lower on the food chain, so we might be having krill salad soon. I don't know about that. We'll see. The next chapter in this book is called Mega Slime Seduction and Shapeshifters. Ah, the lovely hagfish. It's an eel-like fish. It's not an eel. They look like eels. They're jawless, scaleless, and finless. They tend to live in deep, salty water areas in the ocean. And they were actually, the hagfish was sort of the inspiration for the wacky creature story idea of this book. I was in Maine with really a friend of mine, and we were on a boat to go hiking. And she said, I am not going swimming anymore in the Gulf of Maine. I said, why not? Hagfish. There's hundreds of thousands of hagfish living in the Gulf of Maine. They said, well, what's the problem? So hagfish don't have jaws. They only have small teeth on their tongue. And that makes it very difficult to bite through the skin and scales of their prey. So they have to find other ways to get into the interior of the prey, into the organs and the tasty tissues. So they go through the mouth, the gills, and I'm sorry to say, the back door. But don't worry, they tend to feed on dead and dying things. So you don't really have to worry about swimming in the Gulf of Maine. But my friend said, a good friend of hers who's a triathlete who swims in the Gulf of Maine says, during the summer months, I wear a wetsuit because of the sneaky, not because of cold, but because of the sneaky or physiquing hagfish. The hagfish is also known as the slime hag. And here you see a researcher holding a hagfish. Within several minutes, they are said to be able to fill something like 7 buckets worth of slime. And they use this mucus to protect themselves. So if a predator is approaching or they're injured, they start producing this huge quantities of mucus. But there's a little problem. They can suffocate in their own slime. So they actually can sneeze it out their nose, or notice how flexible they are. They actually wrap their tail around their body and then move the knot up towards their head and squeegee off the slime. It's amazing. So hagfish are very important in the ocean ecosystem. They're sort of the cleanup crew. As things dead or dying and they fall to the bottom, they're the garbage crew. They are also very interesting to medical researchers. It turns out they have a very primitive immune system, yet they're feeding on dead and dying things and they don't get sick. So scientists have been looking at that. They've already discovered a very interesting antibody associated with hagfish that they want to do more work with. There's a guy who's looking at the mucus to create artificial material like spider silk. So in the future, we might be wearing shirts and pants made of artificial hagfish slime. Maybe not. And I will say there are some places in the world where they put them on a stick and roast them. Now that sounds disgusting. Sea cucumbers. Oh, how many of you guys have been snorkeling and seen sea cucumbers? They look like pretty simple creatures, not doing a heck of a lot, but they have some sci-fi capabilities. So they spend their time filtering either the seawater or the sediments. Some have tentacles that they wave through the water and they filter organic matter. Some basically suck up the sediments and filter the organic matter that way. But if something comes to threaten them, they can change their sort of leathery skin to kind of a gelatinous goo, slime. But even better, if some predator is coming up to them, they eviscerate. And what that means is they essentially eject their internal organs as a decoy and then crawl away. The analogy would be if a mugger came up to you and you vomited up your internal organs as a decoy and ran away. Not so good for us. But amazingly, the sea cucumber can regenerate its internal organs within 3 to 5 weeks. And so you can imagine, scientists are really pretty interested in how they do that. We don't know yet. They are part of, again, part of the ocean cleanup crew, biomedical research, people are very interested. And there are some places where, yes, people eat sea cucumbers. Anybody here eating sea cucumber? What did you think?
No thanks.
No thanks. How about over here, somebody? What did you think? Did you raise your hand? What did you think?
Chewy but good.
Oh, we got a good no thanks. I've heard kind of rubber band-like, soaks up the flavor. Maybe not. Plus, they're really important in the ocean. They help in coral reefs. They help keep the water clear and clean. So overfishing is an issue with sea cucumbers. Oh, this is one of my favorite stories. So one of the chapters is called Let's Talk Snails. And for this book, I did research. I looked at a lot of journals and scientific literature, but I also sent emails to some of my colleagues. So I sent an email to my friend Al Stoner, who's a fisheries biologist, has been working on the queen conch for years. And I said, Al, do you have a wacky creature story associated with the queen conch? Oh, to my delight. He sent me an email, I swear, said, there's a real advantage to studying the reproductive biology of an animal that is big, slow, mates for hours on end, and has a penis half its total body length. Who knew that the queen conch was so well endowed? And it turns out that the biologists have been writing limericks and poems about the verge. They call it the verge. You know, some romance writer would be like, the long sword, but the biologists call it the verge. But now think about it. There's a good reason for all this. You have the male queen conch sidles up to the female, and he has to get his verge outside of his shell around and under the female's. But there's a little problem. Once the verge is outside his shell, crabs and eels are only too happy to take advantage. But don't worry, men. Lose one, they grow another. Yes, the male queen conch can regenerate his penis. Who knew? Anybody here ever tried to clean a conch? Well, yes, and slime, right? Mucus, they are covered in gooey, sticky mucus. If you try to clean one, it protects them. You actually need like vinegar or lemon to get it off your hands. So they are also friends of the slime. The snails are actually really interesting in the ocean. Another snail is called a pteropod, or a sea butterfly. They spend their entire lives in the water column. The foot has been turned, what we think of as the foot of a snail crawling around, it has been turned onto either these two sort of wing-like fins. There's a shelled variety of a pteropod, that's the shell right there. And then there's the unshelled or naked variety. The naked variety has a very interesting reproductive strategy. They all start as males. They mate as males, swap sperm, and then they change into females. There's no gender issues, no relationship problems. You just change body parts. It's pretty good. And then one of the animals I think I found the most interesting doing research for this book is the cone snail. And it turns out scientists across the world think that they have the most potential of any animal on the planet for pharmaceutical development. And so let me explain why. So it's a snail. They crawl around on the bottom. There's something like over 700 species, and some of them actually hunt fish. Think about that, a snail hunting fish. And here's a good picture of one. And what they do is they lie in the bottom. They have a siphon that sticks up, and they can detect chemicals associated with the fish swimming by. As the fish is swimming by, you know, nothing going on, they actually shoot out a harpoon-like tooth. They hit the fish, and they reel them in on a tether. They have a snout-like mouth, and then they inject them with venom. Now, what's really incredible is that if the first strike doesn't work and the venom is not right, doesn't paralyze the fish, They will shoot another tooth out, and they will change the chemistry of the venom. May be the only animal that can do that. There's already a painkiller on the market called Prior that is derived from the cone snail venom. And the good thing about Prior is for people who are addicted or allergic to an opiate-derived drug such as morphine, they can take Prior because it comes from the cone snail venom. So we're probably going to see a lot more. I will say if you're a shell collector, you had better know what species of cone snail you're getting, because some of them are fairly harmless, others, and one nick and you're dead, even for humans. You don't have to worry about so much here in Florida. The cone snails that are the most venomous tend to be in the Indo-Pacific. The undersea bling. These are some of my favorite creatures. Sea slugs, also these are known as nudibranchs, and they're called nudibranchs for naked gills. And here are, don't be shy. Here's some little action going on. Here's two clown nudibranchs. This, I know which is the front and the back, because one, they always do it head to tail. So here's the tail, and that's its gill, or that's why they call nudibranchs for naked gill. And these funky things here are called rhinophores, and that's kind of like its nose. That's how they sense chemicals. So the nudibranchs always do it head to tail. There's a little action going on there. These are clown nudibranchs. Anybody guess what the common name for this one is? Think breakfast. Yeah, it's the fried egg nudibranch, exactly. And this one is laying its eggs in a template of mucus or slime. Kind of looks like, it looks like reminds me of cake frosting squeezed from a tube. But those are its eggs in a template of slime. Here are some other nudibranchs. They come in literally amazing designs, colors. If you're interested, go on the internet and just type in nudibranch, and you'll be amazed at what you see in terms of their decoration and color and morphology. A related animal is the sea hare, and they have the ability to release an ink as a smokescreen. Snails are also very important, not only to the ocean ecosystem, but to human society. You know, we think of conch. I know I was at a restaurant last night. I tempted to order conch chowder, one of my favorites. So conch is very important as a source of protein. People use the shells and jewelry and as tools. The pteropods, or sea butterflies, are actually called, the shelled ones are called the potato chips of the sea, because they're very important as a source of food for many marine animals. And we actually use their shells. We can get a record of seawater temperature when they formed, and so it's also a way we study climate change. As I mentioned, biomedical research and drugs, also very important. I personally have been doing, I've done a lot of research in coral reefs, so I had to put some cool coral reef stories in. How many of you guys are scuba divers? Oh, quite a few. How many snorkelers? Well, so, as you all know, if you go out on a reef during the day, corals kind of look like rocks. And people sort of think, eh, they're just rocks. They're not rocks. They're animals. But during the day, here's a brain coral, and this is what it would look like. But if you were to go out at night, you would see that brain coral is really a colony of small animals called coral polyps. And they're essentially a ring of tentacles around the stomach. And at night, the coral polyps come out to feed on zooplankton. So that's what a brain coral looks like during the day. That's what it looks like at night. Here's a great close-up of a coral polyp. And you see this one has actually captured a fireworm. Now, coral reefs, real estate is at a premium. Everybody wants space to grow. You've got algae, you've got sponge, you've got corals. And so the corals, because they're pretty slow growing, have to find ways to defend against invaders of their space. Their tentacles have stinging cells, but they also have something else called mesenterial filaments. It's kind of a mouthful. Very hard to get pictures of these, but here's one that I found. This is the coral, and these kind of look like little strings or angel hair pasta coming from the coral. Those are its filaments. And what they do is if something is trying to come and grow over them, they extend these mesenterial filaments from their stomachs out to the invader, and then they shoot digestive enzymes through the filament, and they eat away at the invader. And some corals can actually create a kill zone around themselves. So since it came from the stomach, I couldn't help but say, it's a gut reaction. Oh, thank you for laughing. Well, a scientist years ago discovered, really interestingly, that the slower-grown corals, and those are typically the mound-grown corals, are much more aggressive with these filaments than the fast-grown corals, the branching corals. And it's one way we think that you can have a reef with branching corals coexisting with slow-growing mound corals, because the mound corals use those filaments so the branching ones don't overgrow them. Some of the other residents on the coral reef, what's this?
Moray.
A moray eel. Now, moray eels don't have scales, so they're covered in
slime.
Thank you. Good learners. Anybody know what this fish is? I just love this picture. It is a jawfish, and it's a male jawfish because it is incubating its eggs. The male jawfish incubates the eggs in its mouth. He'll periodically spit them out, turn them around, and pull them back in until they hatch. Pretty cool. How about this fish? Anybody know? Parrotfish, that's right. This is a great image. Not all species do this, but some species of parrotfish actually sleep in the reef in holes, and then to protect themselves, they spin a cocoon of
slime,
thank you, of mucus. And here is a great image of a parrotfish with its cocoon of mucus around it, sleeping. And there's three theories to why they do this. One is that cocoon may be toxic to something that would eat it. It may mask the scent of the parrotfish. Or it could be that it prevents parasites from attaching to the fish at night. Or it could be all three. We don't really know. So when I did this, when I wrote this book, I looked at an estimate of the worth of coral reefs on an annual basis, and I compared it to Fortune 500 companies. And at that time, there was only two companies that had the same annual worth, something like $375 billion a year. And so while we talk about the insurance industry and other industries as too big to fail, coral reefs are too big to fail, one of the reasons we need to protect them. Another chapter, Armed and Dangerous. I love this top image. This is from a colleague, Roger Hanlon, in Woods Hole, who's been studying cephalopods, octopus, and squid for many years. They are the fastest camouflage artists on the planet. And here you can see, it just looks like a rock, and then all of a sudden you see, oh no, there's an octopus. And then you can really tell. Well, what's really fascinating is that Roger has discovered, he thinks that most cephalopods are colorblind. So now you should be sitting there going, huh? Wait a minute. If they're the fastest mimics or camouflage artists, how can they be colorblind? He doesn't know. He thinks they may have color sensing capabilities in their skin. So who do you guys think is funding his research? Cosmetics? The military. Imagine if you had wetsuits or vehicles that could sense color around it and match it. Shape-shifting, essentially. Yeah, so he doesn't know, it's kind of a mystery, but he's been working on it. It's really interesting research. Squid can do essentially the same thing. And here's one of my favorites. So, in octopus, reproduction basically is, the male has a specialized arm, and he basically passes a package of sperm from his body to the female. That's it, no cuddling, no schmoozing, you know, no cigarette afterwards, just passes a package of sperm. In the blanket octopus, it's a little bit different. This is a very unusual octopus. This photo was taken, one of the few I've seen from Key Largo. Here it is, the blanket octopus. It spends most of its time swimming around in the water. Here's the head, there's its arm, and it's got this blanket-like webbing. Now, in the blanket octopus, when the male passes a package of sperm from his body to the female, he also self-amputates his arm and gives her that as well. Talk about self-sacrifice. But then there's a little problem. Once he passes the sperm and his arm, poor thing, it's curtains and he dies. The females, it turns out, they find multiple male arms in her body as she swims around. You know, the one word in the book that my publisher vetoed, I called her a slut. Very bad of me. I had to take that out. Cephalopods are very important in biomedical research. It turns out squid have incredibly well-developed eyes and simple but large nerves, and so they're used to study the nervous system. You know, when I wrote this book, I was thinking about years and years ago, when you went to a restaurant, nobody had calamari on the menu. And now, almost every restaurant has calamari. It's become a very important source of food, protein, jobs, and revenue. So squid and octopus are very important. Ah, yes, also within this chapter are the lovely sea stars. Now everybody knows that if a sea star loses one arm, it can grow another. But you know that if a sea star loses an arm and has part of the central disc with it, it can grow a new body from the arm. So you know what makes me think of those horror movies where you have the hand going like this? It's the arm of the sea star kind of goes like this, and then it grows a new body. Because it turns out they have replicate internal organs in the central disc of a sea star. So if the arm breaks off of some of those internal organs, it can just grow a new body. And the lovely box jelly, we all know jelly, typical jellyfish. The box jellies, such as the sea wasps, are some of the most venomous jellyfish on the planet. They are typically found in Indo-Pacific. You have a few here, but not as many. And they're really interesting. So most jellyfish just sort of pump up to the surface, and then they sink back down, and then they pump up. These actually are jet-propelled. And not only are they jet-propelled and have incredibly strong sting or venom, you see these, they have four, their bell is sort of cube-shaped, and on each face of the cube, they have a set of six eyes. That's what that black dot is. And so they have 24 eyes. And it turns out, scientists think they can create an image to avoid obstacles and to seek prey. But they don't have a brain. So we have no idea how they're processing that image. If they have eyes but no brain, how do they create an image? We don't know. And one of the things I love about the ocean is that there are still so many mysteries and things that we don't understand and are still learning about. I also have a chapter called The Cabinet of Curiosities. Had to put some strange fish in there. Anybody know what this one is? It's the barrel eye fish. It lives in the twilight sort of zone, a little bit deeper, maybe 1,000 feet. It has a transparent shield of a head, and those are not its eyes. Those are its eyes. Because it lives down fairly deep, the eyes want to be looking up for predators or prey. How about this one? Anybody know, what does it look like? It's either called a pine cone or a pineapple fish. And how about that one? Anybody know? I'll give you a hint. It's a kind of shark. Yes, thank you very much. It's a cookie cutter shark. Now, for those of you who don't know, this is, again, a really cool creature. They basically feed by they swim up to a bigger shark, a dolphin, or whale, and they attach their jaws, which they can actually spin around their jaws, and then they pull out a plug of flesh. Cookie cutter? That's why they're called cookie cutter. Now, when I first gave this talk, somebody asked me, oh no, is this another shark we have to worry about? Cookie cutter attack? And I said, oh no, no, don't worry. There's never been an attack by a cookie cutter shark. Turns out, of course somebody sent me an email later, turns out there's a deep water channel in Hawaii where there have been two cookie cutter attacks on people. But in general, you don't have to worry about cookie cutter sharks. But there is a really cool story about years ago, there were submarines that had a rubber covering, I think near like a viewport. And the submarines kept coming up with these round plugs of rubber taken out. And the military, you know, the Navy was like, what the heck is going on? They had no idea what it was. And they finally discovered that it was cookie cutter sharks attacking the rubber on the submarine, so they had to change the material of the sub. They're small. Somebody just asked a good question. I forgot to say, yeah, they're pretty small. They're like that big. So they don't get really big. Thank goodness. I wouldn't want to have to worry about those. Here's another couple cool creatures. What's this one?